And luckily, it stayed true because we've been friends for 20 years. My daughter is now 25 years old. Lynette is here to help celebrate Black History Month. She will share her treasured memories of her wonderful and talented mom, Estelle, who migrated from the South many years ago, who had four children and had an illustrious career as an RN at Hartford Hospital. But not only was she a pioneer in so many ways, but her dad, Lynette's dad, better known as Schoolboy Taylor, Johnny Taylor, was a wonderful athlete. And he was a legendary Negro League pitcher back in the day. So Lynette, without further ado, let me introduce you and you take it from here.
Okay, thank you. Hi again, everyone. And excuse me if I'm looking down because I have notes. There's no way I could have memorized all of this, but much of the presentation today will be in a PowerPoint or keynote format. So you'll be able to read along with me on the screen if you want to exercise your reading skills. And there'll be some photographs. So hopefully it'll be interactive and you'll be able to enjoy more than just watching me talk or hearing me talk. So first, thanks to West Hartford Seniors staff, that's Gina Marino, Robin Collins, Lisa Hance, and probably so many others I don't know, and for the program sponsor for this opportunity to share my presentation. I was initially contacted to share the story of my father, Negro League baseball pitcher, Johnny Schoolboy Taylor, which Robin just referenced. His story has been chronicled in published material, captured for posterity in a retrospective done by documentarian Carol Evans for Connecticut Public Television. And recently, his life has been revisited through an honorary renaming of Hartford's Colt Park Field 9, which is now going to be known as Johnny Taylor Field. The field's million-dollar restoration this past year was part of the historical recognition of the entire Colt family property in Hartford. This tribute was accomplished through the collection of citizen signatures, which allowed a proposal to be put forward by the Hartford Common Council. Corporate sponsors included the Greater Hartford Twilight Baseball League, which my father was part of, and the Yard Goats organization. As my father has been richly recognized for his exceptional athletic talent, it seemed appropriate to me to recognize the great woman behind this great man. And I would actually even say she was never behind him. She was always very much on the same plane. The 2020 convergence of events, including COVID placing us on this Zoom platform, civil unrest in the nation calling for racial equity, Black History Month, and a centennial anniversary, makes this the perfect time to share the life of a Black woman born 100 years ago who always knew her life mattered. This tribute to Estelle Alma Singleton Taylor by a grateful daughter is her testament of love for God, self, and others, intended to inspire us all. In turn, Estelle's life pays homage to those who shaped her life. So the first thing I wanted to do is to ask you a question. What's in a name? My mother's name, first name Estelle, comes from Old French meaning star. It's derived from the Latin stella. The true root is Greek, Eustalles, for well-groomed. My mother's middle name, Alma, comes from Latin almus, meaning kind, fostering, or nourishing. Her maiden name, Singleton, is Anglo-Saxon in origin, and it means farm in the burnt clearing. An alternate meaning that you might know is a playing card that's the only one of its suit in a hand, especially bridge, which my mother loved to play. And her married name, Taylor, is traditionally of French and Latin origin, meaning cutter out of cloth. There's also a biblical meaning of tailor that translates to clothed with salvation and eternal beauty. So Estelle Alma Singleton Taylor's legacy is embedded in her name. She's rooted in a farming tradition, will be remembered forever as kind, fostering, and nourishing. Cut from the cloth of love, humility, and deep abiding faith. Beautiful in mind, body, and spirit. One of a kind. And I would say a true shining star. I'm going to now share my screen, my desktop screen, and hopefully you will see what I've put together. Oh, nice. And once again, it's going to require me to do some reading from my sheet. So I hope you will excuse me from losing eye contact. This, of course, is a centennial tribute to Estelle Alma Singleton Taylor. And I'm going to start playing. I have to find my control here to play my.
John?
Is Lisa with us? I'm trying to access the play button.
So pretty. She beautiful.
I see Zoom. Oh, wait. Oh, there it is.
I see it.
Good job.
Okay, here we go. Lucky for this technical support. Ooh. Thank you. Okay, Estelle Alma Singleton Taylor pictured on a mug. This was a picture of her when she graduated from nursing school, and my sister immortalized her on a mug, which she shared with all of us. This is a centennial tribute because you'll note that my mother was born in 1920, and when 2020 came around, I felt, my goodness, I've known my mother for 100 years. Estelle was born on a cotton farm in Sumter, South Carolina on September 2nd, 1920. And I've kind of done a little visual on the top of showing where that, oh, actually it fell out of place because I moved it. If you know where South Carolina is, find Florida, go up one above, that's Georgia, and then a little bit, take a right and there's South Carolina, and that arrow should be pointing in South Carolina. The prosperous farm in Sumter was 300 plus beautiful acres of cotton and tobacco crops, along with fruit trees, berry bushes, gardens of vegetables and flowers. The property was given to the family by Estelle's maternal grandmother, left to her by her white father, surnamed Metz, and he was of German Jewish ancestry. The home was big with a wraparound porch. A horse and buggy were needed to retrieve the mail. Estelle's mother was an only child who longed for a large family of her own. She eventually had 10 children. The sixth, Patricia Marie, was lost at birth, and Estelle was the eighth child. In 1922, when Estelle was two, an infestation of boll weevils devastated the cotton crop, forcing the property into foreclosure for inability to pay the taxes. While there was not enough to pay the taxes, there was enough to relocate the family north to join relatives in Kingston, New York. Estelle's oldest brother, Elliot, had found work there to support the family. From Kingston, the family eventually settled in New Britain, Connecticut, where Estelle's mother had a first cousin. This next slide is of the grandmother who started my mother's, what she really knows about her lineage. Tracing Estelle's ancestry, we find a grandmother, Clara, raised in Charleston, South Carolina as a white person. Her father was of German Jewish ancestry. Clara became a school teacher. She gave birth to one child, a daughter, Alma, whose father's identity was never revealed. Alma was raised in her grandparents' household in Charleston. After the Civil War, Clara's father found her a Black husband, and his surname was Butler. This is a picture of my grandmother. I never met her, but this is my mother's mother. Her name is Alma Metz Butler. Estelle's mother, Alma, met her husband-to-be attending school in Columbia, South Carolina, where they were both students. Elliot was of African and Cherokee lineage. Alma was very fair-skinned, but considered Black because of the one-drop rule adopted to racially identify people at the time. Elliot had to carry a gun when the couple was in public out of concern he would be accused of breaking the law. Elliot was from a free heritage also because a cousin of Estelle's maternal great-grandfather found gold on the slave owner's land. As a reward, he was granted freedom and 300 acres of cotton and tobacco land, which afforded Elliot the gift of an education, during which he met Alma. And here's a picture of the two of them later in life, my grandmother Alma on the left and my grandfather Elliot on the right. I'm not sure who's in the middle there. Alma and Elliot settled in their East End home at 11 Yale Street in New Britain, Connecticut. And here you see a slide of my mother, Estelle, on the right, and her sister, 2 years older, Ruby, on the left. And they were lifelong friends, pretty much inseparable, more like twins than anything else. And here's another vintage photo that must have meant a lot to my mom. She's on the right. A neighbor named Irene is in the middle. And there's sister Ruby on the left. And what really fascinates me about the photo is those buckled shoes, because I can't imagine children today wanting to take the time to get in and out of shoes like that. At 11 Yale Street in New Britain, Estelle and her family joined a United Nations of families from Germany, Italy, Sweden, Lithuania, Armenia, and Ireland. The children all played together, attending the same schools and participating in activities such as scouting and programs at the Y. I think my grandmother was a scout leader. There were after-school enrichment experiences to enhance the fine arts, including piano lessons and instruction in making lace, tatting, knitting, crocheting, and weaving. Estelle and sister Ruby, between the two of them, were believed to have read every book in the New Britain Library. Mysteries were Estelle's favorites throughout her life. Estelle loved school and excelled. She was often invited to reteach lessons to her classmates and often thought of becoming a teacher herself. While filling out forms in fourth grade, Estelle's Jewish teacher mentioned that she and Estelle shared the same race, which influenced my mother, I'm sure, because she was never one to see color as a divisive factor. The Singleton family worshiped with both an African Episcopalian Methodist congregation and in a white neighborhood church. Here's some photos of my mother as she aged into being a teenager. These are probably pre her going off to pursue her career. But on the left, she's got the legs that she always told us were her tap dancing legs. She had beautiful legs and she loved to tap dance. As a teenager, Estelle enjoyed tap dancing, caring for children, and socializing with her siblings and peers in New Britain. The Singleton home was always open to friends. Estelle's brother was a drummer, and the church choir rehearsed in their home, accompanied by Mother Alma on the piano. One day after school, Estelle arrived home to find her mother and sister Ruby looking troubled. Estelle said, "Isn't it sad what happened to my best friend?" This friend had tragically died in a boating accident. Alma and Ruby had been waiting anxiously to share the sad news and asked who had told her. Estelle said, "You just did." And of course, they hadn't. It was the first instance of a prescience that Estelle would experience throughout her life. At this time, Estelle's thoughts turned to pursuing a career in nursing. She never knew there to be a race issue in New Britain until the Singleton family doctor said he could get Estelle into the New Britain Hospital School of Nursing, but had to admit they'd find some reason to expel her. He advised her to follow her brother's wife, Ruth, to the private Black Lincoln School of Nursing in Bronx, New York. He could then guarantee her a nursing position at the hospital when she graduated. Although this is Estelle's story, it's important here to note the Singleton family friendship with a handsome, athletic young man who was known to walk from his Roosevelt Street home in Hartford, South End, to the Singleton's home on Yale Street in New Britain, Connecticut, a 9-mile trek. During a visit to socialize with the Singletons, 17-year-old John Taylor met 13-year-old Estelle swinging on the yard gate. John playfully patted her head, announcing, "I'm going to wait for you." These are some photos of Estelle with classmates and family in the Bronx in New York while attending Lincoln School of Nursing in 1938. Estelle graduated New Britain High School in 1938 and attended Lincoln School of Nursing in Bronx, New York. She easily made friends and was able at this time to reunite with family in New York during her free time. Here's a picture of Estelle in her nursing cape. Estelle's Lincoln experience was all encompassing. She became the classmate of many friends of friends and outstanding. She became the classmate and friend of many outstanding young women of color with whom she made memories. A social work class visited the Bowery and enjoyed navy bean soup, Italian bread, and fruit cocktail for 10 cents. At Father Divine's restaurant, the students enjoyed fried chicken, collard greens, biscuits, yams, and sweet potato for 25 cents. Estelle declared it all delicious. Among her most memorable experiences as a public health student was caring for preemie twins born at home. The appeal of public health nursing was diminished witnessing what she considered the neglect of children living in abject poverty, sleeping in beds without sheets, and suffering from poor hygiene. As part of her program, Estelle and classmates visited the tombs in Lower Manhattan and attended the cases. Here you see a copy of the commencement exercise program for the Lincoln School of Nursing. And the ceremony was on Thursday, May 7th, 1942 at 3 o'clock. And I have that star next to Estelle's name so you can find her easily in the list. When I looked at the list carefully, there are about 50 classmates and half of them or more were from New York. And then from such places as Texas and Michigan and Pennsylvania, Washington, DC, Missouri, Indiana, Haiti, West Coast of Africa, classmate from Liberia, New Jersey. It's just amazing because I know my mother's circle of friends was so extended during this opportunity. And here's a picture of all of those graduating nurses from that Lincoln School of Nursing graduation ceremony. My mother, once again, I have an arrow pointing to her over on the right. And for those of you who would be interested in this, I know we have one nurse with us. This was the pledge, and I'm not sure if it's the still the pledge that people say when they enter nursing or graduate from a program in nursing, but I found this to be pretty amazing. It's the Nightingale Pledge. I solemnly pledge myself before God and in the presence of this assembly to pass my life in purity and to practice my profession faithfully. I will abstain from whatever is deleterious and mischievous and will not take or knowingly administer any harmful drug. I will do all in my power to maintain and elevate the standard of my profession and will hold in confidence all personal matters committed to my keeping and all family affairs coming to my knowledge in the practice of this profession. So it didn't sound like they had to be mandated reporters. With loyalty, will I endeavor to aid the physician in his work? Now today, that would be offensive because a lot of doctors, I think more so, are women, and devote myself to the welfare of those committed to my care. So that should be of interest in particular to the two nurses here, at least the two. As happens, life's plans can turn on a dime. And 2 years after beginning her nursing career in New York City, Estelle received word that her mother was ill. Without hesitation, Estelle returned to Connecticut to care for her mother, who contacted Mayor Quigley. He was appalled to hear that Estelle had been denied a position at New Britain Hospital and declared she could have any job she wanted. Estelle interviewed for a position and was told the staff would need to approve the appointment of a colored nurse. As fate would have it, the staff was comprised of Estelle's New Britain High School classmates who welcomed her with open arms, establishing Estelle as the hospital's first Black employee. Estelle enjoyed a great working relationship with her former high school classmates, and they were delighted in knowing that her hiring at New Britain Hospital opened the door for other nurses of color. Estelle's love of family had called her from New York and would prove fortuitous. While comforting and supporting her mother, she began a new chapter in life. So from this incident, you realize that Estelle had applied to be a nurse at New Britain Hospital, and she was denied because of the hospital policy not to hire any Black nurses or actually anybody of color. And so at that point, she accepted a position at Lincoln Hospital and continued her education. And she actually, during that time, completed coursework in sociology at NYU, New York University. And she had just started to settle into life in New York, which she found very exciting when she came home to help with her mom. And there's her mother sitting on that porch, 11 Yale Street in New Britain, Connecticut. And my mother always said that I reminded her a lot of her mother. I didn't get to meet her, but I supposedly was like her. All right, this is a picture of John and Estelle in the backyard at Yale Street. And word had reached John that Estelle had returned from New York. And Estelle's mother, who thought very highly of John, let him know. John had watched Estelle evolve from a tomboy swinging on that yard gate and who climbed trees into a beautiful woman of exceptional accomplishment. Separated in age by 4 years, John had preceded Estelle in fulfilling his dream to pursue a career in baseball and was ready to marry and start a family. In February of 1944, John visited Estelle. By August, he had proposed with an engagement ring after asking for her parents' permission. Estelle asked him to wait as she focused on caring for her mother. John went to Estelle's mother to intervene, and with her blessings, Alma asked Estelle to marry John while she was still able to be present. Estelle was lovingly accepted into a second family, the Taylors. John's only sibling, Dorothy, made Estelle's wedding gown and her own bridesmaid gown, which you'll see pictured here. Estelle's mother encouraged her courtship, and a small wedding took place at the family home in October 1944, witnessed by her matchmaker mother before her passing in March of that year. So here you see my father, my mother, and his only sibling, a sister, Dorothy, and that's her daughter, Patricia. I'm not sure in the background who the man is. I may be thinking it was someone in my aunt's life. But here is a picture, a formal wedding picture of my mother and father. And they had, they followed the wedding with a large reception at the lovely Hartford home of family friends of the Taylors. Professional player John continued in baseball, and the couple moved in with his family. Along came John III in August of 1945. With Estelle's mother gone, Etta Taylor, pictured in this photo, became her second mother, encouraging Estelle's eagerness to learn to cook. They enjoyed a closeness which included walks to the neighborhood cinema, where they collected dishes that were offered with the price of a ticket. John, my father, was recalled to Mexico City to pitch, where he enjoyed national hero status. Estelle and John settled in with a family with full use of the kitchen and 2 bedrooms. My mother's Spanish was limited, and the Figueroas, a lovely childless couple in the neighborhood, adopted the young family, declaring little Johnny their grandchild. This was the beginning of a lifelong, long-distance friendship. The Figueroas introduced Estelle to places of interest, including the Palace of Fine Arts, theaters, and a beautiful park where she walked her baby. One Mexico memory with Estelle was Estelle's attempt to preserve her American style cooking of steak. She developed a tapeworm and lost a lot of weight, causing her to leave her appendix in Mexico. Another memory was John's transfer to a team in Monterrey, Mexico, where they lived in the beautiful new home as guests of the captain of police. Unfortunately, in this particular climate, it brought the reality of huge cockroaches and bed bugs, probably a flashback to some of the conditions that she witnessed in her nursing school experience. Home from Mexico, the Taylors settled back in at 26 Roosevelt Street with John's parents. 1946 began Estelle's association with Hartford Hospital. Her sister-in-law, Dorothy, had received a C-section and required special duty care. During this assignment, a former nursing colleague from New Britain Hospital, now at Hartford Hospital, mentioned their need for additional staff. Estelle asked her mother-in-law if she would enjoy caring for young John while she returned to nursing. Of course, Grandma Taylor was thrilled. On the day of Estelle's interview, her crying child gave pause to her plan to return to nursing. Through a tearful interview, she shared her dilemma, and to her surprise, she was hired on the spot. Estelle found contentment and balance in the roles of wife, mother, and nurse. And Lynette, was welcomed into the family in 1948. In 1950, second daughter Maureen arrived, and John and Estelle knew it was time to create a first home of their own. John's baseball days had ended, or were near an end, and he now worked in the building trades as a journeyman lather, working on construction projects around Connecticut. Newly constructed Bowles Park in Hartford beckoned young families. The building of nearby Mark Twain Elementary School added to the allure, along with the multicultural composition of the residents. Estelle easily made friends and enjoyed socializing with other young mothers over afternoon games of canasta while the children napped. Grandma Taylor took every opportunity to ride the city bus to visit. Estelle seized the opportunity to resume her beloved nursing career, working evenings in the maternity department at nearby Mount Sinai Hospital. In 1954, Etta Taylor suffered a stroke. The family was drawn back to Hartford South End to help. Estelle and John purchased a small brick cape on the opposite end of Roosevelt Street from John's parents. Although one stretch of Roosevelt Street was home to a handful of well-established Black families, the opposing stretch had not yet been integrated. This move would last 33 years for Estelle and family. Unsurprisingly, wonderful neighborhood friendships were forged, and Estelle returned to Hartford Hospital. Here's a picture of the home at 139 Roosevelt Street in Hartford. Within walking distance to Hartford Hospital and so much more, Estelle adored 139 Roosevelt Street, which she described as a dollhouse, where she maintained fruit trees, flowers, and vegetables, kind of reminiscent of her place of birth. Estelle devotedly cared for her young family and Etta. Each day when John returned from work, Estelle left for her shift on the third floor of Hartford Hospital's South Building, known as South 3, where she cared for mothers and their newborn babies while developing lifelong friendships with her colleagues. Eventually, John's mother would need 24/7 care in a nursing facility. Up to that time and until Etta's death, she was lovingly nursed by Estelle. That's a picture of my father's mother. The Taylor family, enveloped in Estelle's love, was completed with the birth of Kathy in 1955. So here we are standing right outside 139 Roosevelt Street, and to the back right is a three-family home, and it is, they were wonderful neighbors, and one of the neighbors there is connected to Gina Marino of the West Hartford Senior Center. So this is the neighborhood that was just filled with wonderful opportunity, and Joan Carpenter, who's watching today, might even see some sites that she's familiar with because she grew up in that same place. Estelle introduced her children to the benefits of living in the capital city during walks to downtown Hartford's elegant G. Fox & Company to shop and enjoy lunch. The Wadsworth Athenaeum was visited regularly. There was always a wholesome movie to see at one of Hartford's three movie theaters, preceded by a stop into the Mr. Peanut store on Asylum Street for snacks. Estelle would always dress in her Sunday best for these trips, with perfectly straight seams in her nylon stockings, heeled pumps, gloves, and a hat. With Lynette and Maureen holding onto the sides of the stroller holding baby Kathy, shouts of, "Mrs. Taylor, Mrs. Taylor, do you remember me? You were my nurse." So many felt Estelle belonged to them owing to her being with them at perhaps the most significant time of life, welcoming their children into the world. To us, she was mom. To others, she was a star. Her graciousness made each of them feel like they were Estelle's favorite patient. As our mom, we could have had no greater role model. As our mom, we could have had no greater role model. When we received compliments, Estelle would chime in with her own accolades about us, sometimes to our discomfort. She would remind us that if she didn't have something nice to say about us, then who else should? Here are some photos of us enjoying life at 139 Roosevelt Street. You can see the snowstorms back then. We weren't imagining it. They were worse than now, I think. And just enjoying simple activities, simple toys. As many of us remember, life was just so much more simple back then. And we didn't have so many distractions. In the lower left corner, you'll see a picture grabbed from a screen share. And it's my brother being coached in pitching skills by my dad. And that really distinguished my brother amongst the four of us, is that he was the one that got to receive all of that wonderful tutelage from a professional athlete. Here's some photos of us as we've grown older. With children established in school, Estelle accepted a daytime shift in the newly created Bliss Wing at Hartford Hospital. Until then, she had worked evenings. This is a photo of a couple of photos that were taken out of some Hartford Hospital in-house publications. And my mother's on the left with what looks maybe to be a candy striper or someone holding a newborn. And I think the mother of the newborn holding some flowers. And so this would have been a typical experience in my mother's nursing career, welcoming, you know, an expectant mother and then working to help those two new beings bond, that new mom and that new baby. And I know that her characteristic traits of kindness and fostering and nourishing would have been very useful in those times. Over to the right, I acknowledge that she was born to serve, and the pin ceremony picture represents people who had achieved certain milestones in their careers. And I think at this point, my mother had been with Hartford Hospital for 20 years. And so she's pictured here pictured with some colleagues that are getting their recognition also. Here's a picture of my mother's Hartford Hospital ID. And Estelle was offered the position of head nurse of Bliss West, distinguishing her at Hartford as Hartford Hospital's first Black head nurse. She served in this role for 25 years until her retirement. In this capacity, she embraced the evolving practice of what's known as family-centered nursing. She created a safe and welcoming environment for newborns to bond with nuclear family members, not only just a mom, but with the dad and grandparents and siblings. And this was a highlight of her career. She was very proud to have been there when this was introduced and to foster this approach to the nursing at the time. While cheering on and supporting all of us, her children, through their schooling, Estelle continued to inspire us by attending the University of Hartford to earn credits toward a newly offered RN certified designation. In 1976, she became the first at Hartford Hospital and one of only 11 in the whole state out of 200 to pass. Leadership roles in her head nurse position and NACOG, which is the Nurses Association of the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology, speak to her dedication to the tenets of excellence in nursing. Okay. Now, at age 83, When she was 63, Estelle retired to help care for a grandchild, my son Bobby, born with Down syndrome. I credit his lifetime successes to her love. Estelle was celebrated. Staff and hospital administrators presented her with an unexpected gift, an inscribed Hitchcock chair reserved to honor doctors. Estelle benefited the Greater Hartford community well past her retirement date. She was recruited to work per diem in the Hartford Hospital Clinic, where she showered her loving kindness upon an often underserved patient population. In essence, patient by patient, Estelle changed lives and affected generations. I wanted to share a personal experience here that in the last stage of my first pregnancy with Bobby, I accompanied my mother to attend to some business at Hartford Hospital. We boarded an elevator where a woman extended her arms to hug Estelle. I was introduced, and when the acquaintance exited the elevator, my mother shared that she was the mother of three children who all shared the same genetic anomaly, and marveled at her great love and dedication to them. Unbeknownst to me, my mother's prescience was in work again, and had given her foreknowledge that the child I was carrying was going to be born with a difference. She never told me until well after the birth, and she was there in the delivery room when this new life arrived. I asked what held her back from sharing the news, and she said she knew the baby would be fine, but she wondered how difficult this would be for me and my husband. Once past the tenuous circumstances of a premature birth, this child has proven to be the greatest gift we could ever imagine. Throughout her years, Estelle delighted in traveling both for business and pleasure. An exploratory visit to hospitals in Puerto Rico expanded her background in family-centered nursing. A professional conference in Bermuda provided Estelle and John their first travel together since time spent in Mexico decades earlier. And that would have included a flight. I don't think they'd ever flown anywhere since Mexico. In 1982, daughter Maureen and family gifted Estelle and John a trip to Jamaica. And you can see them in that photo with a grandchild, Megan. In this family photo, which was taken after 43 years of marriage, and my father passed away in 1987, the year before was his 70th birthday, and we had a photographer, actually it was the person who did all of the school photography for the West Hartford Public Schools, and his name was Paul Cryan, and he came through a raging blizzard to take this photo, and I'll ever be forever grateful for that, because this is the last picture we had of all of us together. And the family wasn't totally complete at that time, because Kathy hadn't married, and she has since brought two other grandchildren, two granddaughters into the family. So what I can share with you is the identifications for the people in my mother and father's family up to that point. So starting in the back row, my brother John on the left, John Taylor III, his wife Nancy, and then I'm in the middle with my husband Bob, and Kathy is just below Bob. She's seated and holding her arm around my dad, and then next to her is Maureen, the middle sister, and her husband Michael. And back to the left-hand side is the first of my parents' grandchildren. That's Carrie, and she's the daughter of John and Nancy. And bookending her on the right side is her younger sister, Emily. And then in the middle are Estelle and John. And Estelle is with the two granddaughters of the younger generation of grandchildren, because you can see there's quite a spread in the age of the oldest granddaughter and the younger grandchildren. So with my mother is Megan, and she's the first child of Maureen and Michael. And then on my mother's lap is Beth, and she's the daughter of myself and Bob. And with my dad, he's got the two grandsons, and those, and Bobby on the right, my son Bobby was his first grandson. And Matthew on the left is Maureen and Michael's son, and he was the second grandson. So mostly girls in the family. I'll show you in this picture. Well, I'll wait until we get to the grandchildren pictures. In 1993, this is a little bit of a twist of fate in the family. Daughter Lynette was diagnosed with stage 4 stomach cancer with a very bleak prognosis of a 10% chance to survive. To this day, I will always believe it was Estelle's love that moved mountains in that circumstance. And you can see pictured in 1973, my mother and I on the day I got married. And then past that 1993 date, here we were on a cruise celebrating life in St. Martin with a group of West Hartford teachers and some other people from the town. And so as you can see, we lived on together to be able to enjoy some wonderful experiences. Here's the picture of the grandchildren. This is Estelle with her 8 grandchildren and her first great granddaughter. And this was taken on her 80th birthday. And then over to the right, you can see my mother's first great grandchild, Josh. And underneath that, the second great granddaughter, Genevieve. So in the larger picture from left to right, there's Megan all grown up, and she's now a doctor of archaeological sciences teaching at City College in New York. And she's kind of living out my mother's legacy, because my mother always pictured she'd be the one living in New York, and Megan attended NYU. So there's a great connection there for those two. And then next to Megan is, the first granddaughter in the family, Carrie, and she's the first child of my brother and his wife. And on the other side of my mother is her sister, Emily, second grandchild in the family. And then we have my daughter, Beth, and next to Beth is Maureen's second child, Matthew. In front of Beth and Emily is Kathy's, let me introduce Bobby first. He's down low, but he came in order, you know, with the older kids. So Bobby's down below with the glasses. And then we go back to Taylor in front of Beth and Emily. And there's a Sydney sitting on Bobby's lap. And next to her, in front of her mom, is Marley. And Marley is a great, great granddaughter. So these are the 8 grandchildren of Estelle and the 3 great grandchildren. The picture down in the lower right corner is Estelle at her 90th birthday party. And you can see, remember what's on Genevieve's shirt as we move forward, if you can see what's on her top. Here's a picture of Estelle with her 4 children at that celebration of her 90th birthday. And one of our participants today, Pat Dempsey, was there at that party, so she'll remember this in 2010. Can't believe all those years have gone by. My brother John to the left, Kathy, next the baby, and Maureen, the middle sister, and then myself on the end. And my mother had a huge expression of love on this occasion. People came out of the woodwork, literally from her Seabury community, and filled the auditorium. We sang, we had a video slideshow of Estelle's life, and we enjoyed cake and toasted her, and it was really a festive occasion. This slide you might recognize, perhaps because of your own participation, but my mother was a Red Hatter. And she was in more than one Red Hat group, and every group wanted her to be the, I think there's a name for it, but the head Red Hat person. And it just fit my mother so well to be a Red Hat participant, because I think their whole purpose in life was just to enjoy every day and to think of fun things to do with each other. And so that was pretty much a theme of her life outside of all the other responsibilities that she had. So I wanted to include this picture. I just thought she looked particularly lovely and well-groomed. And that was, of course, a connection to her birth, to her name. If I could go back for one moment, I wanted to just share this about the slide of the, when I was given the news of that very bleak prognosis. It was very difficult news for my mother to hear, and you can think of that in relationship to having the things that had happened through her life to her mother and her mother-in-law and others. Estelle had spent her life fostering and nurturing her family, guided by the best practices of nursing. So how could this happen? Two young children were involved. Estelle jumped into the role of nurse for Lynette and became more than a mother, more than a grandmother to her children. So she became really the mother of my children during this time. She found it difficult to suppress her feelings of sadness. So at my request, she took some time to nurture herself and returned when she did to find a miraculous turn of events, which extends to this day. And if you ever want a program about that, I'm very happy to share. Estelle Alma Singleton Taylor lived long and well, departing at age 93. The dash between her birth and date reveals a legacy embedded in her name. She was rooted in a farming tradition and took that into her life. She'll ever be remembered as kind, fostering, and nourishing. I would definitely say she was cut from the cloth of love and humility with a deep abiding faith. She was beautiful in mind, body, and spirit. And remembering that Singleton name, she certainly was one of a kind. And her name, Estelle, rings true, a true shining star. Our last earthly conversation, my mother and I, took place in the emergency room at Estelle's beloved Hartford Hospital on April 1st, 2014. She now had confirmation of what she already knew, because you remember she's the person that could know things before the rest of us. Her heart was enlarged and there was no treatment. She was prepared to head into the great beyond and told me to look for butterflies, a sign that she was free and happy. Holding Estelle's hand through the night before she passed, I was aware of what a treasured gift I had received at birth. To be the daughter of Estelle is like winning the lottery. The prize never ends. She lives on in my spirit, reminding me to love unconditionally, to be kind, to be gentle and humble, and to know that I matter. And I have dedicated this presentation to my son and Estelle's first grandson, Robert John Grandy, who, along with butterflies and my memories, keeps me connected to Estelle, because he has had some, I think, encounters that I don't understand. One of the things we do together is play Scrabble, and he will come up with the most amazing words. And then you say, do you want to challenge it? And I say to myself, I better not, because they're always right. And then he'll admit, I got it from Nana. So this is all presented gratefully with love by myself. And you can notice in my name, I share a part of my mother's name and my grandmother's name. And I feel it's a name that I never really paid much attention to growing up, but I just cherish having it at this point in my life. So thank you all for allowing me to share this extraordinary life and legacy, which I know would include from my mother a wish for all of you to let your light shine brightly while spreading peace and love and looking for the good in others.
Would anybody like to say something to Lynette? What a wonderful presentation, Lynette. I have tears in my eyes.
Oh, Thank you, Robin.
Beautiful.
Thank you so much. I just wished if you hadn't had a chance to meet my mother, I wish you could have, but you can kind of know her through this presentation, and maybe you'll share this story with others in your life, because we often hear so many negative things about lives of people born Black. And we think it was always so much worse in the days that my mother came through, because there hadn't been the civil rights movement and the laws enacting for some areas to have better outcomes and equality. But I look at my mother's life and it just inspires me to remember that there have always been people who've been able to, despite, you know, the situation in the world, they've been able to overcome on many levels what was denied other people.
We haven't heard about her husband.
Did we see I'm sorry? Him?
Oh, she can hear you. Want to talk with her?
No.
Ask her.
No.
Okay. Is that Ellen?
That's all right. She didn't want to make a comment after all.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, my father's story is always available for the telling, but I really felt at this point in time, it was a really great juncture in the situation of the world that we hear a story that was not told.
I have a question, Lynette. Mm-hmm. I'm Nancy Woods Cunack.
Oh,
and I've had the pleasure of knowing Lynette at Buckley High School. Yes. So she is so much like her mother. I mean, you are. You're just a wonderful person. And I was late coming to this because I got tied up with something else, but I really looked forward to seeing. I saw just a little bit of the end, but I see Robin wiping her eyes. So it must have been really good.
But I can't see you, Nancy, but I remember your beautiful red hair. Am I right?
Yes, it's now a blondish red. I'm letting it grow natural, but anyhow, I'm glad I got to see it. Thank you for-
Great. Thank you. I understand from Lisa Hantz that she's recording this so that it could be available for people to rewatch.
Thank you.
As soon as we figure that out, maybe it could-
A YouTube station that Lisa Hans, by the way, is the person that worked along with Lynette to make this happen today, technology-wise, that is.
She's amazing.
So I just want to acknowledge Lisa for all her efforts every day with the senior centers of West Hartford. But yes, I believe if she's recorded it, it will eventually be on the senior centers of West Hartford YouTube station. So we'll be sending something out when it is available.
Great.
To you. Okay.
Thank you.
I haven't tried to find it.
Would anybody like to make any other comments to our treasured Lynette today for the outstanding job? I know she put a lot of effort into that, as well as with Lisa's help. And I think her son Bobby probably was involved in one way or another as well.
As I have this last slide still on the screen, because I can't figure out how to get my cursor to go up to stop the share. But if you look at the pictures from left to right, you'll see this little child who, for all intents and purposes, really shouldn't have survived. He was born a month early, and they really weren't even able to determine what was going on with him, except through some testing, because what was really the factor at his birth was that he was had a duodenal atresia, which meant that his intestine and stomach were not connected. So he was virtually going to just succumb to that condition. And the day after his birth, he had a very serious surgery and came through with flying colors. We had a surgeon that was just the most amazing man. I'm trying to think at the top, you know, right off the top of my head, his name. I remember his first name was Ronald. And he was a pediatric surgeon. And after the surgery, he had my husband and I speak with him. And he said, I've done hundreds, thousands of surgeries on children, and even children with this particular condition. He said he's wonderful. He's got great muscle tone. He seems extremely hardy. And he said, take him home and spank him when he's naughty and reward him when he does something good. And he said, you're going to find that you just have this child that's like any other child. And it came true. It's almost like we need to keep speaking these things because they really can come to life when we bring them to life in our words. And you can look at him and just see how very engaged he was at a young age. And as I said, you know, I'm sure that love that came from my mother just permeated him because he's so much like her. And then in the second picture, he had just earned a culinary certificate post-high school graduation experience at Manchester Community College through Community Enterprises, a collaboration. They actually could extend his learning from high school where he actually holds a diploma for graduating. And then he went to this program and he selected culinary to kind of appease us because we felt, well, everybody has to eat and you really have to know how to take care of yourself. So learn how to cook. But he had another option to do a business and clerical opportunity, which he would have loved to have done. But I sort of saw that as an isolating situation. You kind of sit in a cubicle and do your own thing. And I really think his people skills were such a big part of him that being in a team situation with culinary would be a great opportunity. So one of the things he did was after he got his certificate is he went over to a local restaurant and he asked if he could learn how to make sushi. And he made sushi and brought it home and shared it with his grandmother. So that's what that picture is all about. And then at my husband and I celebrated our 25th wedding anniversary at our church. And you can see Bobby just always the life of the party. Mm-hmm. He just grabbed his grandmother, you know, and made her his partner and got captured in that picture. And then right next to that one, just a typical situation where he would have been, you know, always very supportive. I'm sure my mother sitting in a walker because she had a walker that she pushed it around. The kids called it her Mach 1, bright red. You know, it just got her where she needed to go. And her story of how she ended up with the physical problems that ailed her at the end of her life is that when she had was going to travel overseas with a friend to Greece, she had a boil on her gum and her dentist prescribed a antibiotic and it was clindamycin. And she would want me to warn you about this. She never took the prescription. He gave it to her in case she ended up having any issues when she was traveling, but she had it when she came back. And I guess she just said, well, I have it and I still have the little boil on my gum. And she started taking it. And she ended up developing C. difficile, which is an intestinal problem from that antibiotic. And it just says right on the label that it can cause that. And then from there, she really went into a tailspin of health crises and ended up at Hartford Hospital where she had to be admitted. And she had become terribly dehydrated. They tried to rehydrate her, overhydrated her actually. And then she had some issues with her kidneys and her heart and was put on more antibiotic protocol. And from that point, she ended up developing a neuropathy, which took away her mobility to a great extent. She was struggling to walk and had to leave her beautiful condo at that time and move into Seabury where she could receive the assisted care that she needed for the last 7 years of her life. But she loved Seabury. Everybody there loved her. She loved them and she had a great life. She said, if you can't be home, be here at Seabury. Yeah. And that picture, the last picture on the right was at her apartment at Seabury. And she was probably 93 in that picture, 92, 93. So never lost her smile, never lost her love of life. So.
Well, thank you, Lynette, for today's outstanding presentation. I could feel your heart throughout the presentation, how much love you had for your family, and especially right now today, your mom. God bless her. And we appreciate all you've done for us and for the seniors of West Hartford, and perhaps you can share another program down the road.
Okay.